Welcome to EO Talks, Eastern Oregon's very own talk show, only here on EO Alive.
Well, my name is Paul Romero. I'm running for governor 2022 for Oregon. I'm a 10-year Navy veteran. I'm a father of five, actually I was a single father of five with three children of my own, biological, and two foster daughters. Youngest now is about to turn 22 in, I think, September. And I have a degree in workforce education and development, double major in mechanical engineering and mathematics, about 75% complete. And no, I'm not going back to school. I've been in project management in the oil field, just done a lot of different things throughout my life and career. And my time in the military, got to travel the world a bit, got to experience quite a lot, including crossing the line of death off of Libya, as well as the Persian Gulf during Desert Shield and Desert Storm. And actually was stationed in Turkey during a big part of Desert Storm. So it's been an interesting Mr. Toad's wild ride, but it's given me a wealth of experience and insights into many things. And for me, it's been about taking this collective life's experience and putting it into something really worthwhile. And that's why I'm running for governor, because I've seen the issues we have here in the state. And I see the gross failures of people that we've actually put in office and people that we've actually put into races. And it is time for us to change that. We don't need the politicians. We need statesmen and stateswomen. So that's really my focus. Well, one thing about joining the military, you know, what's funny is that a lot of people, when you get out of high school, you really don't have a whole lot of direction. A lot of times people are pushing you towards college, and most of us, we kind of lean that direction. The thing is, a lot of times we don't really necessarily know what it is we want to do. And for me, my first year of college after high school, I went to Texas State Technical Institute, which is now Texas State Technical College, for studying instrumentation technology. And after a year of living on Top Ramen noodles and leftover Domino's pizza, I decided to tie a knot in the end of my rope, and I joined the Navy for the GI Bill. The thing about the military is, especially for a young person that's still trying to get out on their own, it's a great experience, not only in that you are out on your own, you're responsible for yourself, but you have a kind of a, at least a corralled area where you have to stay in between the lines. You learn about discipline, you learn about your potential, you learn about your aptitudes, and you actually get a real opportunity to kind of test the waters without, kind of like with training wheels to a certain degree. And it's in stark contrast to those that maybe stay at home for a year or summer, or stay at home for a couple years while they're trying to get enough money in their bank account so they can strike out on their own. So with the military, it just offers a lot of opportunities for a lot of different people. And you know what you learn about being in the military is that the one person that really doesn't want there to ever be a war are generally people that are in the military. They get there, they learn what they need to do, how to do it, and they're confident in that, and they're ready to do it. But ultimately, their ambition and goal is to prevent it. You know, that to me, a lot of people think that just because people join the military, that's what they want. They want war, they want battle. It's just not true. You know, I crossed the line of death off of Libya, where we actually ended up having to shoot down aircraft and sink some boats. And it's a little scary sometimes. And, you know, we during some of that time I was there, we had a ship that was hit by Exocet missiles in northern Persian Gulf from Iran. And it was kind of a scary thing because we didn't know how that happened. Matter of fact, I only learned last year why it happened. And unfortunately, it was due to gross failure of one officer. And but at the time, none of us knew. So a lot of us started sleeping in our workspaces because we're afraid to sleep in our berthings, which are below water, because that's how most people on that attack actually died. They drowned. They couldn't actually escape or get out of their berthing areas. So, you know, it's for some people, it's an amazing experience, and for a few, maybe not so amazing. But the thing is you get the opportunity to step up. You think about in life where, say you were on the football team, and some coach decided, they looked at you and said, you know, you look like a tackle. You look like a receiver. You look like a center. You look like a quarterback. Next thing you know, that's where they've slotted you. That's what you're learning. That's what you're doing. But the truth is that in order to get the right person for the job, you have to try them all out for all those positions. At least then you might actually have a better connection for each person to each position. And with the military, you get that opportunity. Between the ASVAB, which I recommend any and every junior and senior in high school to at least take it once, it'll give you some insight into career fields that you actually have an aptitude for. And that's a really good roadmap because most people come out of high school, don't have a clue. Unless, say, your parents are both doctors and you've been around doctors your whole life. And you know what? I want to be a doctor. You're motivated. You go to doctor school. You already have some insight. And you become a doctor. And you're a doctor the rest of your life. And that's great. But for most of us, that's not how it is. We step out there and we're trying to find our way. And I think the military gives you that step-off point, but with some really firm underpinnings as far as discipline, integrity, loyalty. It really teaches you a lot. The hard part is when you transition from the military into the civilian world, because in the military, whatever job you have, part of your job is to train other people around you. So that in the event that you are removed from the equation, there's plenty of people to step into your shoes and there's nothing lost. Where in the civilian world, people have this mentality of job security. So the less people that are trained and know how to do their job, the more likely they are to keep their job. You know, that there's a big difference there. And so it's just kind of interesting to see. Well, for me as a veteran, when I transferred into the civilian world, it was an adjustment and a half, because the people I worked with in the military, very intelligent, very capable, people I could rely on no matter what was going on. And to have that type of confidence is a powerful thing. And it opens up you to all of the possibilities. And not only in just the work you do, but in the other things you get to get involved in, whether it's project management or audits or whatever it is, you have the ability to cross out of not only what you're doing, your main job, but into other things too. And to go into the civilian world, you walk in with a high security clearance and an experience, a lot of it you can't even talk about. And it's kind of like people look at your resume and they're like, okay, who are you and why are you here? Makes people a little nervous sometimes. So that was actually one of the issues that I ran into because of what I did in the Navy. But if I would have stayed, say, working for the NSA or some other three-letter agency over on the East Coast, that was always open to me. But I was raising a young family at the time, and I didn't want to put that additional stress burden on my family. So I elected to kind of walk away. But that's okay. I still have plenty of friends. Well, right now, I'm the president and CEO of a company called UWalk Today. And UWalk Today is a startup company. We've been in a transition stage because, well, we've had some issues, as you notice, with COVID. And then there's the medical manufacturer we're trying to partner with, as well as distribution for this product. And it's just kind of the bump in the road that a lot of businesses have. The good news is we haven't had to waste any money through this process. So we're just kind of in a wait and watchful stance to engage that. And I actually have other people to take that actually over. So I'll still be the president. My wife actually is the chairman of the board. We don't even pay ourselves for the work we actually do in the course of keeping all this kind of up and ready to go. We're registered with the federal government. So actually one day we'll get to actually sell this product for veterans and people recovering from using different prosthetics or recovering from strokes. It's really a pretty amazing product. My wife, Oksana, was actually one of the inventors and designers of this. So the thing I love about my wife is she's every bit my equal in intellect, in social IQ, in caring about people. She's just an amazing, remarkable woman. And I'm very fortunate to have found her and she me. So that's the one thing. And eventually one day that'll be our primary work. But one of our goals has been to keep the manufacturing actually in Oregon, to keep the main central distribution to start in Oregon. Eventually it'll also be in the central and East Coast as well as overseas. But for now, we're trying to really make it an Oregon product. And I think that it's just the right thing to do. We need good jobs here in the state. And we have people that handle machinery and stuff that can actually build these products we just have to get the right partnership to engage that. And the nice thing is we'll be able to employ a lot of great people and actually give them a very good living wage. And that's important to us. The other thing I'm actually doing right now, I'm working for the VA here in Roseburg. I don't want to go into too much detail about that, but as you can imagine, veterans are kind of near and dear to my heart because I know what they've been through, because I've been through it. The good, the bad, and the ugly. And I know that even here in Oregon, we have things we need to improve on. So for me, I do what I can. It's enough income to keep our noses above water, which is really all we're trying to do. But right now it is a 40-hour work week for, in that regard. And then I have a full-time campaign schedule. So between all the research that I do, my research teams, and all the information they bring into me, kind of shorten some of my work, it's just nonstop. And so I do my Facebook Lives Wednesdays and Sundays on Paul Romero for Oregon Governor. And yes, I'm one of the few people still on Facebook to be able to do that. And I speak my mind. I don't hold anything back. This is the lion's den. And when people come here, they're either one of the fellow lions or they're prey. There's no in between. But that's basically what I've been doing now. Well, the first thing is, and this is really a pretty surprising statistic, is that in the last election, and we really went hard on this because we needed to know what the real makeup was of the Oregon voter and what the transition's been. You've always heard how, oh, Oregon's run by liberals and, you know, Portland, Salem, and Eugene, they all decide everything and there's no point in us conservative Republicans even voting. And that's the mentality. And the thing is, that's the narrative that we're being told. And then on top of it, especially after Bob Packwood, they came out and started saying, oh, you know, we got to move more to the left. We need to be more moderate. And then if we do that, then we'll take over enough vote and we'll take over and we'll be able to fix everything. That's a lie. It's just not true. It hasn't worked for the last 30 years. They tried to employ it. And we all know the definition of insanity. And for those people that profess that, they're one of our biggest internal undermining forces we have. So in the last election, there was 26% of voters were actually Republicans, 36% of registered voters were Democrats, 6% independent, and 32% were non-affiliated voters. Now, what we found is that the Oregon Republican Party, the Republicans, registered Republicans, have been exponentially decreasing. Not good. And the Democrats, amazingly enough, are actually on the same trajectory, but about a year to a year and a half behind us. However, that's picking up steam. They may actually overshoot us, but that may be another full four-year cycle. Then you also see voters since the last election to present day moving out of the establishment parties and into non-affiliated voter status. They are fed up with politics as usual. They're fed up with the people that claim they're doing all this work and they're not. They're tired of the people that are fighting it who are actually doing nothing. And they're just tired of it. And then there's all the people that are still in the Republican and Democrat parties that really don't have any place to go. They don't feel they'll be effective as a non-affiliated voter. They want to be able to vote in primaries, have some effect on who gets in. And it's really sad to see. And for me, the thing that's shocking is that, you know, Democrats claim to be the socially aware group and that they take care of people and homeless and all these social issues. No, they don't. In fact, it's easily argued and proven just by their very actions and the results that they've increased these problems. They've not reduced or fixed any of them. So one of the first things they used against the Republican is that, oh, you guys aren't socially aware. The heck we aren't. You know, the things we do voluntarily, we don't need anybody to tell us to do them to help people out. We do it normally. And it's time for them to see that and realize that, hey, nothing they've been told, it's all been a lie. It's time to shift gears. And the thing that's awesome is that within the Democrat Party, there's the JFK Democrats, the conservative Democrats, the Blue Dog Democrats. They exist and they're in force here in Oregon. And they're not very happy that the Democrat Party has accepted this socialist ideology without their permission, number one. Number two, just out of the fact that that's what they've done. It goes against the grain of most of what they all represent. The nice thing about Democrats is they're very loyal, which is really pretty impressive. With the Republican Party, you don't see quite that type of loyalty. It's just a little different. And here in Oregon, we've literally watched our Oregon Republican Party be dismantled from within, from the highest levels. And the worst part is they're so sly and so good at what they do. They've been able to keep us on that steady decline for the last 22 years. And we've been trying to shine a light on the truth, and we know the truth, but it's been very hard for a lot of Republicans to swallow because it tells them that they were wrong. Nothing's worse than having to admit when you're wrong for most people. And in the Republican Party, we see that all the time. Now, we do see the local levels, the county levels are actually in pretty good shape overall. I really believe that. And they're trying to fix things. They're trying to get more PCPs, get them involved, trying to get new, different blood into the Central Committee, which is actually very important. And once you get good, solid people, and I'm not talking about moderates, there is no reason for moderates. We need to have clear choices. And Reagan said, you know, no pale pastels. And here in Oregon, that's all we got. The way I see the entire governor's race is that it is full of pastels and one bold color, and that's me, okay? And the kicker is that most people think, well, you're not going to be able to pull in the Democrat vote. Huh, that's not true. What I've learned is this, is that we've been giving up the middle ground for years, and we get nothing for it. Yet, no one's ever focused on the common ground, the things that actually lift all boats in Oregon. And as a governor, granted, it really should be a nonpartisan type of race, but it's not. There's always going to be partisan parties here. But the fact is, who actually goes in with a plan and with a commitment to doing something? And most candidates will not do that for fear of offending some part, some segment of the voting public that's going to take them down. You know, they think they can please everybody. You can't do that. But I'll tell you what I've learned. If you've read my contract with Oregon at all, what you realize you'll find out is, wow, you know what? This is the kind of stuff that Democrats, independents, libertarians, even Republicans and non-affiliated voters, they're like, you know what? If you do this, you need even a part of this and you have my vote. We can't look down our nose at the voters. And what I see in a lot of candidates is they put on this politician's face and they are not genuine. And people pick that up. And with me, what you get right here is exactly what you get when I'm speaking in Bandon or Bend or wherever I'm at. I'm just a real person. I'm just a genuine person. And that's who our candidates need to be. And in the course of being truly genuine and being honest and transparent, it not only gains you the trust of voters and the people you get to speak with, but it opens up so many more doors and people get excited about what you have to offer. And then the thing I put in their minds is, what do they have to offer? We have an entire legislature that has been grossly ineffective. I'm not talking about the Republican side. Let's just talk about the Republican side. I think we have a bunch of well-intentioned people, yet they have compromised themselves. And in the course of doing that, they've compromised the voting public, the very people they represent. And this is a huge problem. There's only so many bullets in the gun when you have a supermajority that's running the show, as long as you have a quorum. And what's funny to me is a couple cycles back, we had, 17 legislative races that went unopposed. The Oregon Republican Party didn't even bother to go out and find a candidate in all these races. And Democrats just ran it through, right? That set us up for where we are today. Oregon Republican Party leadership. Oh, I should say lack of leadership. There's no leadership in there. It's a bunch of people all trying to be the chief and no real Indians. Okay. Call it delusions of grandeur, call it whatever you want, but it's a mess. These are people that don't really know what it means to be a real leader. You know, a real leader gets out and does the job. A real leader will get his hands dirty. A real leader, even in politics, although me personally, I'm not a politician. I'm a pragmatist. I'm a problem solver, problem fixer guy. And what it is that they have a very different approach. They don't really want to give a solid answer about any particular topic because, like I said, they're trying to appease a whole lot of people. Can't do that. You got to be bold. You got to be succinct. And you got to explain to them, this is what's wrong. This is what we're going to do to fix it. And make no doubt that once we get in office and we have that ability, we're going to make this happen. And it's our commitment to you, the voter. It's how we're responsible to them, how we can be statesmen rather than politicians. We don't need politicians. We don't need these perennial candidates that keep popping up all the time and saying the same stuff over and over again. And I myself, as you may know, I'm a staunch Trump supporter. Now, most people say, well, that's going to work against you with all these the liberals in Oregon. I think you're wrong. Actually, no, I know you're wrong. I talk with these people. I find out with the comrades. I talk with the homeless. They don't want a handout. They want a hand up. All right? We have the solutions to help the state of Oregon and to get it back to a place where we all are going to be very happy with it. And right now we have management that's not doing that. It's not real leadership. It's really poor management is what it is. And within the Oregon Republican Party, it's no more evident than it's also evident there, not just at state level, but within our own party. Now, we have good people in the Oregon Republican Party, and I know a number of them. And I also know a number of them that are not so good, and they're poor judges of character, and they even when you stick the evidence right in front of their face, they question it. And I'm just like, you got to be kidding me, really? Here's the proof, and you guys still don't want to listen. Okay, you know what? That's your problem. That's not mine. So for us, basically, it's a matter of we expose candidates. We I want people to know if there's a good candidate or not. People need to know if they can trust the candidate or not. So in the course of me running for governor, the thing I've been looking for is good, solid candidates to run for a U.S. Senate seat. Six U.S. House Representative seats. And then, of course, every seat in the House and legislature, with the exception of a couple. Okay. That's what we have to do. We have to build a solid team, because at some point, even if they're a Democrat, if they're a really good Democrat, good conservative Democrat, I'll talk to that person. I have no problem having a conversation with them. But what I have to do is I have to take my contract with Oregon, and we're building on it still today. And I've signed this. I've committed to this. Here's all the people that are going to help me accomplish this. They're going to commit to this contract with Oregon. And in doing that, we're going to recover Oregon, make it bigger, better than it's ever been, and get Oregonians back to thriving instead of just surviving. So it's a long answer, but there you go. Well, first thing I'll tell you straight up, I'm a Christian. I'm a spiritual Christian. And I believe in redemption. I believe people need and deserve the opportunity to rectify their wrongs. And there's a whole lot of people in the state that, well, need to redeem themselves in a lot of ways. I've been given all kinds of philosophies and things from my grandfather growing up. But one of the biggest things I push is never give up, never surrender. That's the other guy's problem. But that has to come from a position of strength. It has to come from a position of leadership. If you're not lined up, if you're not good to go, then you have no business speaking that way. But what I'm running into is that there's a lot of candidates that they can't speak from that position. And the more I learn about them, and I know about all the candidates, and I mean all of them, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I'm some of them really shocked me. But I understand more about who they are than they do. The fact that they're even sticking their nose in this arena tells me that they really don't think people are going to hold them accountable for the truth. Well, I can assure you that's going to happen. And for me, I've had people try to dig up dirt on me. Now, when you have a highest security clearance you can have in the military, you got to be a Boy Scout. You got to stay between the lines. That's who you have to be. You have no choice. But it's not really that a hard place to stay. It also makes me very dangerous in the political realm because, well, they just don't have dirt. They're going to have to somehow try to leverage me or something like that. Well, they first found the wrong Paul Romero on one thing a couple years back, and then they realized, it's the wrong Paul Romero. Oops. Then they found a thing regarding my now ex-wife and I regarding child custody, where children were kidnapped across state lines. And they dug that up. And then they realized it wasn't me who kidnapped our children. It was my ex-wife. And I won all those court cases. It was just kind of funny. It's kind of a little trap for them. And they fell into it. And that was fine. And then finally, there's a Republican that was running for office last go around who ended up losing. And they ran a little game. I know all about it in great gory detail. Unfortunately for them, because people within the plan didn't realize who I was, what race I was running for. But what they did was they tried to file an FEC complaint against me, claiming we weren't recording all our funds to the FEC and everything like that. And the truth is, we were. everything was golden. It was good to go. But it was a way to try to generate dirt. Well, there's an FEC investigation on Paul Romero. Well, yeah, it fell flat on its face. The best part now is I get to use that stick to whack the heck out of that individual and any of his little swamp rats that were surrounding him. So I'm kind of looking forward to that. Payback is a bitch, right? Gosh, you know, the thing that was a little surprising for me when I looked up Oregon's governors, we've had a lot of Republican governors, but believe it or not, they were very middle of the road. You know, they're actually pretty moderate. And I think that really came from kind of a, I don't know, I really don't know where it came from because it didn't make a lot of sense, to be honest. But as far as any specific, you know, I have mentors here in Oregon that I really respected. Thing is, none of them got into public office. They never wanted to. And that's one of the other problems we have here in Oregon. We have a lot of great people that should be in office, that should be in our legislature. They're too busy with their own lives. They're successful. They're like, you know, I just don't want to bother. And I understand. But it's kind of like jury duty. Sometimes you just have a certain obligation to step up to the plate and help the rest of the state. So one of the people, his name is Don Perkerson. And Don's not with us anymore, but I met Don back in high school playing basketball after school. And I remember running into him and knocking him down. He was an old guy, you know, and he was out there with his knee brace and he was playing basketball. He was pretty good. He used to teach, used to coach girls basketball, I guess. And I got to know him there and he became a mentor and he had great advice. He tried to convince me to join the FBI at one point and I considered it. But then when Obama got in office, I stepped away. Because of the work I did in the military, I had some knowledge about him and there was no way I was going to work for an FBI controlled by Obama. So he was probably one of my biggest mentors and he was the most, salt of the earth Christian you'll ever meet. This was a man who survived. He's one of the chosen few. I don't know if you know what that is. North Korea, Chosin Lake. And he was one of the few people that survived that engagement. That was one of the last people out. And I remember him telling me a story about he was put in charge of driving the one and only officer that survived out in this one Jeep. And they had to go slow. They were being snipered nonstop. People were being taken out all along that path out of there. Once they finally got to safety, he got out of the Jeep. And as he got out of the Jeep just stopped running. This Jeep was like Swiss cheese. And Don was telling me basically is like it was such an amazing thing because he knew beyond a shadow of a doubt the only thing got him home safe and alive was God. And for him and the lieutenant that was in the vehicle, the Jeep with him, that was kind of a really big moment for them because their seats had holes through them and yet they were unscathed. And that'll make a believer out of anybody. But for him, you know, he was that awesome Christian, a true good man who really cared about other people. Didn't matter who they were. And I think that's important because if you can't relate to people on a real basic fundamental way, in a significant way, you have no business representing them. And I think and I see a number of people running for office that are really in that top 1%. They cannot relate to the vast majority of Oregon. And that to me is a huge failure on their part. Now, that is their life. That's their path that they chose and where they went. And it's not to say they didn't do good things. But ultimately, how do you truly represent? We have a Congress that is so out of touch with America, mostly. They're not really representing us. And that's another breakdown in our government. But it has to do with who we put in office. People get stuck on money, right? I had one person approach my aide at an event that I spoke, the Northwest Safe School Summit, sponsored by the Parents' Rights in Education, an organization run by Susan Gallagher, and she's an amazing woman, done amazing things. She knows the truth about the Oregon Republican Party and the history. Anyway, my speech was on critical race theory, and it was kind of like drawing the short straw a little bit because I think it's kind of an intimidating thing, especially back when I did this, and I knew all about it. I was on it, and You come out and you make these statements. And at the time, a lot of people that were in the, they didn't know I was running for governor. After my speech, it was about lunchtime and we broke and everybody got my business cards. And that's when they found out. And I was approached by a number of people who had seen another candidate speak and walked up to me and said, you know, we were going to vote for this person. However, after hearing you speak, you now have our vote. And I was like, well, wait a minute, time out. I just spoke on critical race theory and where I stand on parents' rights, basically. I don't think that's enough to judge that yet. I said, you need to take a look at my contract with Oregon. You need to see where I stand on all these things. But I really appreciate what you're saying. Make no mistake there. But I felt that should be more to it than that. But what they said was that how I spoke, how I related with people, how I came out with such knowledge, and how I made it easy for them to understand, and that they could then pass it on to other people. And they said that they really appreciated that. So one of the pieces of advice I got from my grandfather, who gave me great advice, he said, one of the best skills you can have in life is the ability to speak with the lowest ditch digger or the highest executive and everybody in between. And if you can do that, no matter what it is you do, you will be successful. The best part is you'll also have a lot of friends. And I like that idea. I think even people that are very diametrically different than us, don't judge a book by its cover. And believe me, we have some very interesting covers in Oregon and in Portland and all over the place. You got to give people a chance. You have to look past what's on the surface and get to what's in the middle. And that's a big focus for me. I know a lot of people are hurting. They've been through a lot of pain. And we have a government, a legislature that's responsible for this, and definitely a governor who's become a tyrant dictator, especially with the emergency clause they've abused. And when that was coming out, there's all kinds of people fighting against it, and not enough people in the legislature saying no. It went along. And right now, we have a huge violation of the public trust by Republicans in our U.S. Senate, in our state Senate. They have one bullet in their gun, one to shoot, one to fire, and all it is to deny them quorum to pass all these bad bills that they're passing. And they keep trying to throw it at us and tell us it's raining, and it's definitely not rain. And to me, that is a huge disservice to the people that put them in office and trusted them, and to the rest of the state that had no choice in who they were to be selected. This, to me, is actually a twofold problem because, like I said, we have no real leadership, not even a Republican caucus. It's a joke. And with this leadership issue, you go and you look at the Senate. You take a look at the Senate, okay? And you had certain people that did walk out of these things to try to deny them quorum. And then you had those that refused to walk, saying they're going to stay there to do their job. Well, you know, Democrats used the same strategy before in the past to stop us, okay? Well, what's fair? It's just another tool in the political deal. The key, though, is, of course, getting that real true common ground and working from there. But we don't see that effort or leadership at all. The problem I have, those that actually walked, there's some of them that they claim they walked, but in fact, they had excused absences. And you're going to have to go look that up. And you're going to find a couple of going to find at least one gubernatorial candidate out of that group. Didn't really walk. They just got an excused absence. And then you have those who didn't walk and stayed. The guilt really lies mostly on them. However, the problem that I have is that there wasn't a single person that walked that had the stroke, the spine, the leverage to get just one more Republican to walk. Not one of them. There's no strength in the Oregon Republican Party. There's no leadership in our Republican caucus and legislature. There's none. These guys do not have a plan. They've been flying by the seat of their pants. They've accomplished nothing of significance. And yet they expect us to just keep putting them in office. You know, I've heard arguments about, well, you know, I got elected, so that means I'm better than you. Let's see. You got elected. You're in office. Did you even use politics to leverage the opposition to come over to your side? Believe me, there's plenty of dirt on these people. You could leverage them. But you didn't even bother to try. Now, they do that in a heartbeat against you, but you're not even willing to play that game to help Oregon. You failed. So you keep patting yourselves on the back for being there and accomplishing nothing. If you were in a business, a corporation, you would be fired. And I don't just mean fired. I mean like fired out of a cannon. I think they'd be justified in that case. So right now, like I said, it is imperative. We need new blood across the board. And what I tell people, if they have the mind, they have a good record, they can be vetted, they are truly who they claim to be, then they need to understand that everybody can learn how to become a legislator. No one goes through a course and has to get a college degree or something to be a legislator or on the school board, on city council. You get in these positions, a lot of time it's OJT. You learn as you go. And as long as you're of good heart, good mind, and are willing to do the right things for the people and be a true servant to the people, there you go. That's what you need to go do these things. And I see an awful lot of people in my opposition. I tell people, it's like, I feel bad when I have to go up against unarmed people. And the way I see pretty much everybody that's entered the gubernatorial race as unarmed. And if they want to come into my arena, you better be real careful. Better have your ducks in a row because I'm bringing the heat. And they're not going to like it because they're guilty. And I'm just going to expose them. So it may seem kind of harsh. And it's like, well, you know, we're not so, what about Reagan's 11th commandment? You know, do not speak ill of fellow Republicans. Well, if they were true Republicans, maybe that rule would apply. But for many of them, they are definitely not. They are rhinos. They're moderates. They don't even follow the party platform, for crying out loud. And they have the audacity to try to stick their nose in this arena. What really kills me is this Oregon Republican Party old guard that's still pushing the moderates. They're still pushing the Newt Buellers. And it's like, this has been dismal failure nonstop. It's like they're trying to lose. Okay? Their strategies don't work. But I think they don't work on purpose. I think they've picked that strategy because it doesn't work. But it does waste some money. There you have that.
All right. Well, we'll end on a lighter note. We got a little lightning round for you.
Okay.
So first off, ducks or beavers?
You know, I growing up, I started out as a beaver fan because all my friends went to they were beavers, you know. Had a Oregon Beavers football jersey I wore whenever I went skiing, along with my kamikaze headband. Because when I was screaming on the mountain, get out of the way, you know. And of course, with the ducks, well, you know, started following the ducks. And it's been a lot of fun. Really enjoyed watching them. But you got to admit, they've been kind of neck and neck, right? You know? So it's kind of like this. When it comes to them playing against each other, well, I'm gonna take the ducks. And when it's elsewhere, I'm going to be rooting for both of them, whoever else they're playing.
All right. What's your favorite Oregon landmark?
Oregon landmark. Gosh, I am Boy Scouts. I've hiked all over the place. I've camped with my family, fishing everywhere. There's one place I like to go a lot, because it's really as close to the sky as I can get. You know where Big Summit Prairie is in the Ochcos?
No, I don't think so.
They kind of did a big solar. Remember when the solar eclipse happened? They did that huge event out there. The guy was brilliant in what he did. I gotta hand it to him. But there's a place up there I go to, Allen Creek Reservoir, that I really enjoy. But you got to know how to get there. It's kind of back roads and back trails, and you better have four wheel drive. And that's a place where I like to go because literally. You might be able to get a text out if you're out in the middle of the reservoir. Okay. So it kind of makes it quiet. And at night, that starry sky is like a screensaver. It's amazing. So kind of like that.
All righty. What's your favorite Oregon beer?
Oregon beer. Gosh. Well, you know, I'm going to have to go with the 10 Barrel Apocalypse. But I also, my wife and I are both rather fond of Amberbach Dark. Which actually for me comes from my rugby days with the University of Louisiana Raging Cajuns. And for Oksana, she likes that beer too. So now we'll share one here and there. It's kind of fun.
Nice. What's your favorite place to visit in Eastern Oregon?
Eastern Oregon. Wow. Man, there's so many places. There's one place, it's kind of historic. It had to do when Japan was sending balloons. I don't know if you're familiar with the story, with bombs on them. And the goal was to try to set up forest fires on the West Coast to basically burn Americans out of America, right? The good news is it failed. The bad news is one of those bombs landed and unfortunately killed a woman and a number of her children during a picnic. when they found it, you know. And but that's kind of a place. It's pretty historic. It's kind of important, and it it's a reminder, you know, that things can happen in your backyard if you're not careful. You got to be mindful, you know. And for Oregon, we in this day and age, with some of the opposition that's encroaching on the inside, it's literally trying to. It's like a cancer, and we need to address it. We cannot ignore it, and we've been ignoring it in Portland from mayors and our governor too long. We need real safety and security for Oregonians just by enforcing the law.